my career right here in Northwest Oregon, fighting for workers and for businesses that were a little down on their luck. Debbie and I grew up right in Washington County. Actually, we met when we were at Lowell High School in Tom Hughes' civics class. And we raised our son Nathan and our daughter Claire here too. I own a small business here. I know what it means to need to meet the payroll and pay for the benefits for your workers. You then sent me to represent you at the State House and at the State Senate where I got the job done for us there. And let me tell you how I did it. Bringing together those same diverse groups, we passed the Oregon Renewable Energy Act, the expansion of Oregon's first bottle bill in 4 decades, and the Agricultural Community Water Act that's getting water to badly needed communities in rural Oregon. Just like I've done all along, I will work hard to get the job done for you in Congress as well. Thank you.
Chambers. especially Big Al's for hosting today. I would like to challenge my other candidates afterwards at this time for the bowling match. I think that'd be healthy for us. I'd also like to introduce my wife, Allison. If Allison, you could just quickly stand. Allison, appreciate you being here today. Thank you. My name is Rob Cornelis, and I'm a small business owner. What does that mean? Again, 16 years ago, I had an idea. And with the help of a supportive spouse and a spare bedroom in our home, and tapping into some funds from our savings account, I started a business. And in that time, we have been able to employ more than 60 Oregonians and their families. Also, over that time, my family and I have learned to make our own personal sacrifices in order to stick to a budget. For 192 straight months, I've done what's necessary to meet a payroll. Yes, I know how to consistently sign the front of a stack of paychecks. And occasionally, as a small business person, you learn that when times are tough, you need to take that last paycheck from the staff and slowly and quietly put it into your desk drawer because you realize it would not be good for your company to pay yourself. You see, being a small business person who actually created something, who actually worked collaboratively to get results with people of varying economic, educational, and ethnic backgrounds is what makes me the right candidate for this district at this time. Right here in the First District of Oregon, I believe we have some of the greatest resources the country could offer. We've got world-class innovators and entrepreneurs here in Beaverton and Hillsboro, not to mention all of Washington County. We have nurseries and vineyards in Danville County. We have the rivers and ports to export goods across the globe in Clatsop and Columbia County and Multnomah County. And of course, we have the economic hub of Oregon in downtown Portland. Yet back in Washington, D.C., we are the forgotten district. Sadly, because of a lack of responsibility and a lack of accountability, we are the only congressional district out of 435 that does not have a voice today. Now, especially now, with all due respect to the other candidates, we need proven career builders, not proven career politicians. If you're ready for a champion, an advocate, someone to work with small businesses, workers, and employers, to help return prosperity to this district, I'm Rob Cornelis, and I am asking you for your support because I'm ready and eager to be your representative. Thank you.
Energy generation nation's economy literally rides on the wheels and the transoms of our nation's transportation infrastructure. And in terms of communication, it's absolutely critical that we not constrain any portion of America that's ability to grow jobs and to grow business. And right now, one-third of our nation is digitally hampered. It's also critical for us to rebuild sustainable Medicare and Social Security systems, and for us to end the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, and take the money that we save and begin to pare down our national debt. Thank you very much. These are the issues that are of importance to business. These are the issues that are of critical importance to consumers and workers. These are the issues that I will ask you to support my candidacy for Oregon's 1st Congressional District. Thank you very much.
Question number one, and the order of answering is going to be Brad, Rob, Suzanne, then Julia. Question number one, District 1 is among the most densely populated districts and leads Oregon as an employment center. If you're elected, how do you hear and balance the needs and voices of your rural and urban constituencies? Mr. Witt.
The needs of both our rural and suburban district portions of Oregon's congressional district really are not all that different. It is of critical importance for the entire district for us to grow jobs. Jobs needs to be job number one, number two, and number three. And as I outlined in my opening statement, it is critically important that we focus on that infrastructure development that will grow our entire district economy and make it possible for all citizens, rural as well as suburban, to be able to resume their role in spending in our nation's economy. We're facing a consumer gap at this point. Growing jobs is how they
overcome that. The role of the representative is very unique because you do, as the question suggests, you do have to represent a very diverse group of people who have varied interests and priorities and values. This is why I think I'm uniquely qualified to take on this position, because in my professional career, I have visited every major community in our country, and I have worked to make wherever I was a little bit better through business enterprise I was involved in. And at the time, I did not ask people what political party they were in or what their views were on political issues. We simply focused on the results that needed to be accomplished, and we worked collaboratively to get to those results. I also think it's important to recognize that wherever I go in this district, people are very clear. They want to have a simpler tax structure. They want to have more certainty in their business and in their entrepreneurial ventures through lowering regulation, because regulation has gotten out of control, and they want to be able to maximize or capitalize on the assets that exist in the first district and not be hampered in that effort.
I do my research, and I
farms strong. We're also, in Northwest Oregon, have terrific strong businesses in industry. And both can survive and do very well for our state. What we want is to have as much of the housing and the industry closer to the city, just like we have in our urban growth plan. And we want to do all we can to preserve the beautiful open spaces and the tradition of family farming that we have from where we're sitting right now to the coast. It's something that Oregon is known as a national leader in, and it's something I think we can continue to be very successful at.
Thank you.
Question number two. Reauthorization for a new highway and aviation bill has been up in the air and operating under multiple extensions for quite some time. With infrastructure investments being as vital and important as they are for economic development and job creation, how would you plan to advance a reauthorization bill? This time we're going to start with Mr. Thank you,
Gavin. This situation that Kevin just described is, to me, a great representation of what's wrong with Congress today. We as a people are frustrated, we're oftentimes angry at the indecision of Congress because they refuse to work together. There's too much gamesmanship. There's too many political games going on. And quite frankly, I think it's because they've grown up in the system, the people in Congress today. They know what's necessary in order to win political battles as opposed to doing what's best for people back home. We need a strong infrastructure. We need all of the things that come in this aviation reauthorization bill. But we can't be tacking on things to it that make it untenable. We simply need to focus on the matter at hand and stop worrying about the other things that make it untenable to the other side. We can reach consensus if we put people back in Washington who know how to work collaboratively and put their hands across the table to get something done.
I agree that we must pass the reauthorization bill, and unfortunately too many people have already lost their jobs because it wasn't passed when it was up before. We need to get people back to work, and what we need in Congress is an effective leader who has experience working across the aisle. And I've done that in the Oregon legislature, and I will continue to do that in Congress. And as I've been talking with people across the district, people are frustrated. They're frustrated with Congress, and when they watch the debt ceiling debate, they saw, something that disappointed them greatly. What we need is someone who is effective and who has a record, who's ready to get to work on day one and making sure that we get people back to work and passing that important legislation. And as I mentioned, I have experience doing that. The most recent example is the challenging redistricting bill. We set out to get that passed in the building and we got it done with my leadership. I'll continue that leadership as your next congressman.
This is a great example of how Congress is sitting on its hands when we've got 200,000 people here that are either out of work in Oregon or they can't find enough work in order to make ends meet. And that transportation bill and the WPA program I'm proposing should be passed immediately to get people back to work again. And it's true, it's important to build consensus, to build relationships, and move things forward. I will stand my record up against anybody's on the ability to get that done for you. There's a reason I was selected the Consensus Builder of the Year my last year in the state legislature. Passing the Oregon Renewable Energy Act has made Oregon a leader, a national leader in green jobs, the expansion of the bottle mill, return shop classes to our public schools, all done with labor, with industry, with the Republicans and the Democrats, not groups you often see standing side by side on progressive legislation, moving those bills together, and that is what I will do for you in Congress.
Thank you. This is a perfect example of the kind of infrastructure development that we so desperately need. I will share with my colleagues in Congress the importance of transportation to our nation's economy, and that it's a path for us out of recession and back to prosperity. Be it airborne or ground-based transportation, have the most modern and efficient transportation network of any nation in the world. That will guarantee our future global competitiveness in this international marketplace. Absolutely important.
Thank you. What is your experience in working with or in businesses, and how would you relate to, support, and communicate with our local businesses? Amen.
Thank you. I made it my priority in the Oregon legislature when we had a session in 2010 to approach Business Oregon, our state economic development department, and say, what can we do to help grow business in Oregon? And I worked with Business Oregon to streamline the process for small businesses to apply to the Entrepreneurial Development Loan Fund and the Business Development Loan Fund. And in a challenging session, we passed that bill with bipartisan support, and we were able to recapitalize those loan funds. And the day after the governor signed that bill, business was getting a loan from Business Oregon and creating and keeping jobs right here in Oregon. I'll continue to work with Business Oregon and with all of you get ideas about how we can best help Oregon businesses. And I'll take that leadership in Congress, where I'll continue to help small businesses and all businesses in Oregon, and I'll be a champion for the first thing I know.
Well, I have been a business owner. I own my own business that served much of our community here for a decade. I know what it's like to be the payroll and provide benefits for your employees. And I am the Commissioner of Labor and Industries for the state. And many of you know, as part of the chamber, one of the first things I did when I took that office 3 years ago was travel Northwest Oregon, meeting with every chamber of commerce we have and every business association we have to let them feel welcome at the Bureau, to provide the services we can provide to help make their businesses successful. And I created the kind of relationships that you need with bringing not just labor to the table, but bringing business to the table in order to craft policy that helps businesses succeed in this state. And that's exactly the way that I will serve you as business owners and residents of Northwest Oregon Commerce.
My profession is that of a union representative and labor leader. I work with business each and every day. I've spent the past 2 days in Pendleton, Oregon, assisting one of our employers who's having a hard time making ends meet. They produce a very high-end quality product, which is very difficult in down economic times for sales. People simply substitute cheaper products. We have helped them expand their product line. We have helped them find additional markets to sell in. And we, on a daily basis, for the past year and a half, have been working with representatives of that company to plan its investments and bring that company back to a successful company. As a negotiator, I know how to reach across the aisle and work with people of the other party as well as my business counterparts. Thank you.
I don't just work with companies, I help companies succeed. And that's what I've been fortunate to do for the last 16 years in my little business called Gameface Incorporated. As I mentioned, we started out of our house with an idea, and we grew it to be an industry leader in the sports and entertainment world. Now, for those of you who don't really like sports, I know you don't like entertainment, but if you don't like sports, my clientele are professional sports teams. 400 professional sports teams around the world have come to Gameface. They've come all the way to Tualatin, Oregon, to learn how they can run a more efficient, a more cost-effective, frankly, a more successful, and ultimately, of course, a more customer-friendly, customer-centered business. So I don't have a learning curve when I get to Congress as to what business needs to do to be able to hire more. I'm in the thick of it right now. I continue to have my business even while I'm running for Congress. So you will have a champion, an advocate, if you'll help elect me, because I will be someone who's not only friendly to workers, but friendly to the people who must employ those workers. Thank you. Well, we all know that the jobs, 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 what a lot of things are about right now.
Well, let me start with the thing that I've already done for you. That is to make sure that there's nowhere you can go in this world that has a better trained workforce than right here in the state of Oregon. And that's why last year I built a coalition to bring those shop classes back to our public schools, and I want to take that to a national level. The other is this. When I talk about a 21st century WPA program that'll put millions back to work, I'm not talking about the plan that was outlined by the president that puts $50 billion into infrastructure needs across the country. That's a little over $400 million for this state, 5,500 jobs when we have 200,000 people out of work. I am going to push for more when we get to D.C. because we've got to start thinking big in this country again. And the other is this. We are continually sending our jobs overseas when we've got people that are out of work right here. I want trade agreements that put our country on an equal playing field with the rest of the world and bring jobs back to this country. I will not support agreements that take jobs away from the American worker and the American company overseas.
Three things. First of all, identify where we can be most effective and where we can best put our resources. And again, energy, transportation, communications, public buildings. Number two, convene a citizens group of experts in the area, both labor and business, as well as consultants. Determine how we're going to develop and design that program. Point number three. Every single person in this room has connections back in Washington, D.C. We rally all of our resources, all of our connections, to apply the very best lobbying effort we can possibly do to make these investments in our infrastructure now and get our economy back up and rolling.
Both Brad's mentioned two things. I'd like to reiterate training. Database has trained nearly 30,000 executives around the country how to be more successful in their work. Gathering more experts together in committee, we don't need more committees. We need people, representatives who already get it, who are in the trenches right now. The three specific things we need a tax simplification. The tax burden that we have now, the tax code, is so complicated. More than 6 billion hours were spent last year by American taxpayers just trying to figure out how much money they owe. We need to also lower regulations. They're out of control. We need reasonable regulations to protect us. But last year, 8.8 billion hours were spent by American taxpayers just filling out government forms. And we also need to recognize, number three, in Oregon, we have terrific assets that are not being exposed. We don't have a voice in Congress, but these assets, when put to work, will create jobs. They come in the form of energy production. They come in the form of talent, human talent, that right now doesn't have that.
Three things. First, infrastructure. We can get people back to work right away, repairing our roads and bridges, electrical grids, and water systems. Second, access to capital, which I've already mentioned. It's incredibly important for small businesses to have that access to capital. I've worked on that in the legislature. I'll continue to work on that in Congress. Third, we need a strong system of public education, pre-K through life, so that we're turning out people here in Oregon who will be the creative innovators of tomorrow. One of the things I did in the Oregon legislature is remove unnecessary mandates so that our teachers can spend more time teaching and less time filling out paperwork. Now, that's the kind of deregulation I can support. Some of our education decisions are being dictated by No Child Left Behind in federal legislation. I'll make sure that our local decisions are creating the best students and critical thinkers for the jobs of tomorrow. Thanks.
Thank you. Okay, you put your math heads on for this one. Pretend the federal deficit is $100. Pretend. I said pretend. To close the deficit to zero, what percentage should be revenue enhancements, and what should be expense reductions, and what are the top three places to look for making those adjustments?
revenue enhancement. Certainly, I think this has to be expire. People who don't have a job can't benefit from a reduction in income tax. That money needs to be reinvested in our nation's infrastructure. Jobs would be number one, the investment would be number two. In terms of additional revenue, I don't think we go there. That's number three. Last but not least, in terms of deficit reduction, I suggest the place where we start is saving the money from the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. Thank you.
The reason why we have such a severe deficit is because we have politicians that don't know how to stop borrowing money when we don't have. If they can learn some simple common principles that we in small business have to live every single day, first and foremost, you don't spend money you don't have. I don't, by nature, don't know how to spend other people's money. I only know how to spend what I've earned. Second, we don't need more taxes, we need more taxpayers, as some people have said. If we can raise the number of people paying taxes into the system, we fix a lot of the problems that are going on in our country right now. So the question that we must ask ourselves is, not should we give more money to government that has shown, the federal government has shown, they don't know how to spend it wisely, stimulus package, Solyndra, and other ventures, but rather, how do we raise the level of number of people paying taxes into the system? You do that by creating jobs in the state and throughout the country.
$147 million of taxpayer funds
being used in a six-year process that hasn't even produced a shovel in the dirt yet. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the problem with government. There's no transparency, there's no accountability, because elected officials believe that they have a blank check with your money. If I'm involved in this process, I will make sure that it gets done, and it gets done affordably and on time.
Now, the bridge needs to be built. We spent a lot of time deciding when, how, how long it's going to take. Build the bridge. Build the bridge now. My role as your congressman is going to be to make sure that the federal government is contributing its fair share to this project that spans two different states. And that's where the ability to build consensus, build relationships, to actually roll up your sleeves and get the work done pays off. I've done it for you in Oregon, and I will do it for you in Congress.
One of the key problems with the Columbia River crossing is not unlike what our state faced in terms of siting regionally significant industrial development zones. I helped get that bill out of Ways and Means, a subcommittee this session, because I knew how to work with my counterparts across the aisle, as well as bringing labor, business, environmentalists together as to try and find a set of best practices where building that bridge would result in our leading the rest of the nation with a set of best practices that demonstrated just how you build this kind of project and how you keep it on schedule and how you move forward and how you address the concerns of environmentalists, community activists, as well as labor. It's bringing folks together like I have done in the legislature and in my profession.
Thank you. Suzanne, you've already touched on this, but I'd like to have the opportunity to expand and to hear from the other candidates as well. For both the chambers of Congress, we know that education from birth to death is vital for all of us and for the success of our region. What role should the federal government have, if any, in improving the educational system to make us and keep us globally competitive?
Thank you. I got involved in this business because of education. Standing on the steps waving Save Our School signs, doing everything from building a playground to serving on district committees. So it is a key to rebuilding our economy. And the federal government does have a role, but not as a local school board. We need to have local decisions about how students are taught. We need more support for our teachers, not just funding, which is desperately needed, but evaluations that are meaningful and that help our students and teach them how to be critical thinkers. And we need less standardized testing. There's a place for assessment and accountability, no doubt, but right now, teachers spend way too much time teaching their students how to take tests. I led the effort this last session to limit the number of tests, times that students need to retake standardized tests. Let's make sure that our students are becoming creative, critical thinkers. And we can do that here in our Oregon schools, which are some of the best in the country. Let's make them better. Thank you.
You know, some of you will remember, we grew up in Beaverton when we used to have a band and an orchestra at every elementary school. Local decisions we made on how we wanted to raise our children. Well, those were eliminated in the early 90s, and when that happened, I helped pull together a group of parents and people who could really play musical instruments, not me. And we started Southwest Music School that has served thousands of local kids since that time. But there's a reason we don't have those classes. There's a reason I had to work hard to get the shop classes back this last time. There's a reason that the federal government should not be involved in the local decisions on how to run our schools. Last year in the legislature, I passed the bill asking Congress to exempt Oregon from the No Child Left Behind Act. That is not the bill that I will present in Congress. The bill will be to repeal the No Child Left Behind Act and race for the top and let local communities make their own decisions regarding how to
Education is what leads to successful careers for our students, global competitiveness for our employers and our companies, and a thriving economy out into the future. All too often, our federal government has gotten in the way of global initiatives, and you've heard references to No Child Left Behind. Just like the other brand, I too will make it a priority when I go to Congress to make sure that No Child Left Behind is overturned, and that we no longer teach children how to take tests, but rather how to think independently and be able to thrive in a global economy.
This is an issue which obviously we all agree on. We all agree that education is the key for our kids' future, which ultimately is our future, because we'll be looking to our kids for leadership and innovation in the future. In my own business at GameFace, since the year 2000, we have taken college graduates who have not been able to find careers in their chosen field, brought them to our business in Walden, Oregon, from all over the country, even internationally, and we've trained them in skills that have permitted them 75% of the time to find full-time jobs within 60 days of working with us. I'm an educator. I also would say that within the realm of the federal involvement, nobody in Washington, D.C. knows better than we locally on how to educate our kids. And that's true for every single community in the First Congressional District. I have trust in the teachers in the classroom to know how to best provide resources and methods to make sure our kids are prepared to compete globally.
Thank you. A highway reauthorization bill is paid for using gas tax revenue. Using the current revenue stream, which has not been adjusted since 1993, how would you suggest we maintain adequate funding for the infrastructure?
Well, Kevin, I really do appreciate the question and don't want to just repeat what I said before, but Congress sits on its hands swallowing about minuscule amounts of money here and there and where they're going to cut and where they're going to raise taxes. When the truth is, we need to look more closely at where we're spending our money now. And I had heard it when I tell you that when we're spending billions of dollars overseas when we can't take care of the infrastructure needs of the families of this country, that's a problem. When we're allowing huge Wall Street corporations to not pay their fair share, that has an effect on whether or not we can put people to work on infrastructure problems in this country. And so my first order of business is to make sure that we are using every one of your tax dollars wisely towards the infrastructure and the family needs of this country. Later, after that house is in order, then we can have a broader discussion about whether or not we look to cut some revenue changes.
The question was about revenue from the gas tanks. And quite simply, with energy savings per vehicle, with some vehicles using very little petrochemicals for fuel, and with a down economy when folks are driving less, we simply are not getting the revenue that we once did out of the gas tanks. No mystery here. We simply need to find an alternative means. And it is very difficult if we continue to rely on the fuel tax, given that we're moving away from those traditional fuels. I would take a look very seriously at the common denominator for all vehicles, and that would be tires. And I think that we could obtain revenue on the purchase of vehicular tires.
Rather than inventing another program or more taxes, I think the American people today would just like to see government utilize the resources we've already given them through our taxes properly. Excuse me if I'm a bit cynical when government leaders suggest more taxes, when currently 18% of the last stimulus bill that was passed in 2009 still hasn't been used on highway infrastructure and improvements. Why? Because the bureaucratic nightmare process to get that money to, quote, shovel-ready jobs. So before you ask the American taxpayers as a Congress to submit more of their resources to existing problems. Let's take care of the monies that have already been devoted to those problems and make sure they're going properly. This is why Americans are sitting on their hands about tax increases. This is why they don't want to see any more. We need more accountability and more responsibility from Congress and people who have the mindset and the temperament to see to it that that happens.
There are people who are out of work, there are people losing their homes in foreclosure, there are people trying to find jobs. They don't need to be paying more for a gallon of gas, they pay a lot right now. They need to be able to get to work, they need to be able to take their kids to the doctor or go to school. We don't need to be raising their gas tax now to work on roads when there are other sources of funding. Let's talk about alternatives. Where are we spending our money? Where can we get money to get people back to work on infrastructure without making it harder on those who weren't responsible for that financial collapse together? So let's watch out for those who are struggling, those who can't afford an increase in gas tax, and let's find alternative ways, whether it be through federal funding, through an infrastructure bank, which is a long-term solution, or other ways that we can get the revenue we need to put people back to work. But let's not do that on the backs of those who are struggling.
Thank you. The last question we'll have time for today. I don't think it would be a stretch to say that a major frustration of people who are not in Congress is the inability of Congress to work together to come to some coalitions and to make things happen. As a Democrat in a Republican-controlled House, or as a Republican in a Republican-controlled House, how do you reach across the aisle? How do you advocate for our needs? And how do you help everybody to hear each other's voices?
I'm a professional negotiator with over 30 years of experience. And that experience has enabled me to reach across the aisle and work with my Republican colleagues. And that's precisely the reason why I was able to reach more agreements on legislation in the 2011 session than any one of my colleagues in my Democratic office. I'm able to find those areas where there's agreement. That's part of my background. And I will use that background and my abilities to go back to Washington, D.C. And break that partisan gridlock and reach the same kind of agreements I do, not only at the legislature, but at the bargaining table each and every day.
I'm not a professional negotiator, I'm a professional doer. Example, last December, a few friends and I in Portland decided that there was a way that we could help people create more jobs in this community, in this region. And so we took this idea, and I don't even know what political affiliation they belong to, and we presented it to the mayor of Portland, city councilors, county chair in Multnomah County, the state treasurer, representatives of the governor's office, members of the Portland Development Commission, community leaders, business leaders, state legislators, and most of them didn't belong to my party. And I simply suggested, if we work together on this, if we put aside petty differences and work on the ultimate goal, which is to put more Oregonians to work in a sustained fashion, we can accomplish something great together. That's the kind of mentality and skill set I will bring to Congress if you'll be so good to elect.
From consumer protection to education.
Kim, you're right. Honest is broken. It isn't working. Let's talk honestly about why that is. When the November elections are over, somebody's got to flip the light switch off and turn to relationship building and government. And that isn't happening in Congress. The campaigns continue to churn their way through the legislative process with all the elected officials looking at where their next campaign check is going to come from and how they can set up their opponent better. And that's why we're not getting the results we need in Congress. Let me just throw out one idea that you might like. Something I really enjoyed about this congressional race is it's only 95 days long.
Yes.
Are you tired of the 2 years of the regurgitation of the campaigns before we get to the election? Let's have Congress pass a law that says every campaign is going to be 4 months long. Let's get the big money out of politics and get back to government again.
Thank you. And thank you, each of you, for answering those questions on the spot. Just so you know, they did not have the questions in advance. They were all coming at the same time. We'll end today's session with each of you giving a 2-minute closing, and we'll stop and start.
You've heard the outline of challenges that our nation's and state's economy face. You've heard me tell you about how our traditional approaches do not work. In fact, for the very folks that we're trying to help, those middle-class folks who need to have a paycheck to be able to spend that at our local stores and businesses. I have outlined for you the basic infrastructure developments and modernizations that we need to begin investing in today, so that by the end of this decade, we have the best infrastructure of any nation in the world, and the United States of America continues to be a global leader in our worldwide economy. You've also heard me talk about my success as a professional negotiator. And this is critically important. This is critically important to be able to reach across that aisle, to be able to bring agreement where before there were only differences of opinion. Those are things that I have done and done successfully and continue to do, both in our legislature as well as in my professional career. I have addressed the issues of importance to businesses, to workers, and consumers. I've addressed those issues head on that will make a difference in our state and national economies. And it is on that basis that I ask today for your chambers and the members of the chamber and individual folks in your businesses for your support for my candidacy in Oregon's 1st Congressional District. Thank you so much for this opportunity to present my candidacy to you here today.
Again, I want to thank the Beaverton Hillsborough Chambers for their kindness in hosting this, and Rivermark, thank you very much, for Big Alice. And I also want to thank the other candidates for their comments. These are good people. But we're not here to just elect a good person. We're here to elect the most effective representative for the 1st Congressional District. I'm grateful last year to have received the endorsement of the U.S. Chamber of Commerce. And already in the last 6 weeks, I'm humbled by the fact that 17 mayors in our congressional district have already decided to endorse me for this campaign. Now, why would these bipartisan mayors decide to endorse me, a small businessman? Simply because they recognize me as someone who will listen, someone who understands, and someone who will work tirelessly to make sure that jobs are returned to their communities and that those communities will see economic revitalization. And if you'd like to learn more about who's endorsed me, both on the civic side as well as the business side, I would encourage you to visit my website, CornelisForCongress.com, but please go back often because we're adding endorsements daily. You know, it's been said, if you continue to think like you've always thought, you'll continue to get what you've always got. And for too many years, we haven't been getting what's right for Oregon in this particular district. I'm asking you today, ladies and gentlemen, to raise your expectations, especially with those that we elect. It's not too much to expect of elected representatives who understand it's not your money they're spending, who understand what it means to write and stick to a budget, who understand that you have to make sacrifices to pay bills and leave a payroll. These are the things that you do every single day as all small business owners and operators. And it's not too much to expect the people you elect to do the same. Raise your expectations, I'm asking you today, of what a congressman should be and do. And as you do that, I hope to earn your support. I'm Rob Cornelis. Thank you very much.
I work hard, and I get the job done for you. I've done it all my life here. succeed as your Commissioner of Labor and Industries. I'm going to Congress for you, and right now, I'm working hard to earn your vote. My name is Brad Avakian. I thank you for your time, and I thank you for your support.